But then we had clients coming back to us and say, can you do everything remote? And I said, yeah, of course we can do that.
Maybe you can get in touch half a day before you actually publish the post and we'll keep it embargoed.
IPOs offer both partial or full exit. And if you stay with it, then obviously currency for acquisition.
And welcome to Slator Pod 44, today with a special co-host here. My name is Florian. I'm joining you from Zurich. And we have on the other end of the line,
Andrew Smart, also commercial director of Slator and business partner and friend to Florian Faes.
There you go. Where are you joining us from, Andrew?
Well, I'm based in Asia. I'm out here in Bangkok, enjoying the tropics and the warm weather. How are things in Zurich? Is it getting colder yet?
It's getting colder and it's getting worse and COVID is spiking and lockdowns are being discussed. But I don't know, how is the situation in Bangkok?
Well, COVID-wise, there's freedom of movement, but the country itself is largely locked down. So at least I think you can move between countries in Europe, but leaving and traveling around Asia is still highly restricted.
Because you used to be based in Singapore for a long, long time, right? But currently you can't go there?
Can't go there right now. Singapore is actually negotiating travel bubbles. They're talking to Australia, they're talking to Hong Kong, they're even talking to New York and the US and Europe. But it's still very, very much locked down country by country here in Asia.
All right. Well, we're going to go through, you know, what's on in the language industry, and you know, we're really looking forward to getting your take. Esther's on a, you know, vacation, deservedly so. So we have another special guest today, or a special guest. We have Kim Ludvigsen, the current CEO and soon to be no longer CEO but vice chairman of Interprefy, the remote simultaneous interpreting app. Or app, well, not an app, technology, right? Platform. And so we're going to have him on right after this. But first, today on the agenda, we're going to talk a little bit about the TransPerfect results, the what's it, Q3 results that were out. Some interesting stuff to dig in there. Then we're going to talk about Facebook's MT announcement that was quite big this week. And then a quick dive into the Zoom Zapps, and we'll tell you what this is all about. On the log job side, continue to get a good amount of jobs coming in. Anybody who's interested, hop over to logjobs.com, post your jobs. Lots of great discounts. You've been sending out a few discounts, code, right, to get people to start on the site?
We have. There's been some exciting take-up. We have a number of employers on there, and we're starting to see a pretty decent flow of job applications and recruitment going on. So Check it out,
definitely. And then another announcement, of course, we got SlatorCon Remote. We briefly spoke about it last time, but you're really in the lead on that. So, Andrew, why don't you tell us a bit more about SlatorCon Remote?
Well, you know, here in the COVID era, everything has moved online, and this is our second SlatorCon Remote. And we have an exciting lineup. We have Benjamin from Accolade, who's going to be our CEO speaker. We also have Jamie from Lionbridge, who's going to give a great case study on digital transformation. We've got an exciting panel in life science. We have Intento, and hopefully Constantine will be the speaker as our lead partner. That will be great. A lot of discussion happening around MT, as you know. And then also we're looking for a couple of other exciting speakers to announce in the very near future. We also have Dora Worth as our networking partner, which is great. And so all we need is, you know, perhaps a panel partner to join us on the life sciences to make the discussion complete. So if you're interested, again, let me know.
I like it on the partner front. So Intento, again, it's the MT curation technology platform. And then Dora Worth is a London-based life sciences LSP. So it's at the different ends of the language industry spectrum. So if there's any interest out there, get in touch with Andrew about the panel partnership. So we're also using a different platform this time, right? We're going to trial it in a couple of weeks with the India, online conference. I don't know, webinar, what should we call it? But we're going to trial the platform. It's called Hopin. What are your initial thoughts about the platform?
Well, I'm excited to trial Hopin. When we first did our first SlatorCon remote in July, we used GoToWebinar, a very robust platform. But some of the feedback we got was around extending the Q&A. And so Hopin offers breakout sessions. And also in terms of networking, it's got some really interesting one-on-one video networking capabilities. So we're hoping that this tool will, you know, not just help us provide the content that people want, but the additional Q&A and networking that they also asked for. So it's quite exciting.
Yeah, well, I'm really looking forward to it and trying to figure this out, how to do remote conferencing so people can really do network. I mean, they can network, right? I mean, it's obviously limited and you don't have the kind of serendipitous encounters, you know, that you have at a conference, but I still think you can recreate part of the experience. So looking forward to checking out that platform in a couple of weeks.
I think there's one other interesting element about SlatorCon Remote that we haven't touched on, which is you're going to be opening it again, and you're going to be doing a little crystal ball gazing into 2021. So do you have any thoughts you can share at this time to tease the audience a bit?
I'm sharing a lot of thoughts in that podcast. No, it's basically, there's going to be more visuals to it. We'll need to see. There's still a lot of stuff happening, and we'll try to time usually these presentations to make them very relevant. Like, so if I already started to think too much about it right now, and then something big happens by December, you know, I do want to be in a position to include it. So that's both challenging to make things kind of that timely, like presentations very timely, but it also, I think people like it as opposed to, you know, basically pulling out like a stock presentation you did a year ago. This year, obviously, you know, there's so much happening. I mean, you know, we had the RWS a bid, we have Aquila buying on Plexor, and, you know, so there's maybe something like that's going to hit, and we're going to have to talk about it. First, though, TransPerfect, they're losing the crown, or losing. They're relinquishing it. They're losing it. Somebody else is going to take them. So when RWS buys SDL, then TransPerfect is no longer going to be the biggest LSP by revenue. That said, though, I was really impressed by their figures for the third quarter. Apparently, their numbers or their revenue was up 13% to $213 million in the third quarter compared to the same, like the third quarter of 2019. You know, you tally it up, you get to, if you analyze it, you're over $800 million. So that's quite the top line there. And they said that that revenue growth was because of pent up demand. So, you know, the demand wasn't killed by COVID, but it was pent up and then it was released in the third quarter. And then they also said they had a great month of September, which was up 20% compared to 2019. I find it's very interesting. I mean, and also TransPerfect is very diversified, so it's a bit of a bellwether for the entire industry. Now, what we have to say, top line growth was supported by some of these bolt-on acquisitions that they did in Q4 last year, like these, especially in the media space, they did a bunch of acquisitions. But even if you exclude that, I think there was still, we spoke to Phil Shaw, the CEO. He said it was, I don't remember the exact percentage, but roughly half-half, like half was organic and half was M&A driven. So, in terms of the sector, can you just remind us what was strong, what was weak? I mean, I don't think any major surprise there, though, but...
Well, I think one of the positives of TransPerfect has always been the strength of its sales team. And you know, they are across, as you've highlighted, a number of verticals. So they mentioned that life sciences was strong, but obviously travel and hospitality less so. There's also been a lot of activity that we've seen and that you've reported on in the media space. So I think, you know, within the mix of things, there's been, you know, good upper single digit organic sales growth, which is truly impressive in this environment. And then, as you mentioned before, M&A. So it's a winning strategy. We've seen in the LSPI in the past, this combination producing the greatest revenue growth. So it's really an impressive set of results.
Why do you think they publish it all? I mean, I think I've asked Phil Shaw this a couple of times, but they said they did this, they've been doing this for a while, but I mean, they're a private company. Why do you think they, is it just because the numbers tend to look good and it's basically a PR exercise, or why would they want to publish revenue, like quarterly revenue figures as a private company?
Well, certainly, it has been so far good news to share. Even through their legal troubles, they were producing really impressive sales growth, and so it's a good story to get out there and share that they're continuing to make impressive progress for a company their size. So these absolute dollar additions in sales are truly impressive. So why not crow about it? And I would actually encourage any company to try and put out whatever news they can about themselves. It's an opportunity to gain more visibility.
And tell us ahead of time. Tell us ahead of time. We'll embargo it. We'll ask you questions, and then we'll write a piece about it. It gets into our financial results. So don't be shy. Obviously, I also asked Phil Shaw about the RWS SDL merger, what it means, and he said basically may present an opportunity to them because clients may want to avoid to have all eggs in one basket. And on the talent side, if there were to be kind of efficiency, streamlining, headcuts, etc., that maybe some talent may become available. He didn't go further than that, but it's something similar we heard from other LSPs. Like, I don't think anybody is particularly concerned, at least publicly, right, that this is going to make a huge difference to their lives as competitors. But maybe even presents an opportunity. Also, what I asked him, or what we asked him in the interview was like, why doesn't anybody IPO in Europe or the US? And he said that many of those bigger players are actually owned by private equity firms, and so they don't need to access capital via an IPO. What's your take on that? I mean, you're a former stock market analyst. I mean, shouldn't they go public? And don't the PE guys eventually want to get out and maybe sell or get, sell via an IPO rather than via another PE firm sale?
The PE guys have been, selling to each other. If you look at BTI Studios, they've sort of been moving up the food chain, if you will, of private equity owners. So there have been some exits, but you're right. It is a little bit mystifying why, partial exit and additional liquidity from an IPO hasn't been more prevalent with some of these companies, especially when you look at companies like Keywords and RWS, who are using shares as part of the acquisition price. So when they go out and make a deal, it's, part debt, part cash, part shares. So, IPOs offer both partial or full exit. And if you stay with it, then obviously currency for acquisition. So I'm kind of surprised that there haven't been more activity in this space. And the markets are at record highs. So, this would be a great time to get those share valuations, I think.
I don't get it either. And especially that Australia seems to be is the place. We got AI media, we got Straker. We spoke about it many times in the podcast, but I don't know. I think somebody should IPO at some point. It would be great for us because now we're losing, with SDL being, swallowed up by RWS, we're losing another publicly listed company. So, it's good. It's good for our editorial too. They're so transparent, so we can write about them.
I would be very curious about Lionbridge. Lionbridge, are in private equity hands. They sort of sniffed out the Australian IPO a while back, and then it all went quiet. I wonder if they might reemerge. That would be a very interesting story.
That would be an interesting story. Back to public. I remember when I heard that they're going to go private. It's like a business trip. I'm like, oh no, now we're going to have to write about it. It's like, I'm on a plane. Don't pull the company. I think they were on the NASDAQ. So one company that's definitely on the NASDAQ is Facebook. And they had a pretty big, at least in their view, a pretty big announcement this week because their comms got in touch with us and asked us if we would like to speak to the, the project lead, et cetera, which is rare for some of these big tech companies to, go out to the media. Well, maybe not to the media, but to us specifically, and ask if we'd like to cover a story. So it was about a progress, or they would probably call it a breakthrough in what is called massive multilingual machine translation. And they called it that it was the culmination of years of their work in machine translation. That's quite a big statement to make. And we spoke about, I think before, about massive multilingual. It was one of those bigger trends over the past couple of years in MT. And basically it means instead of having a bunch of different models for different language combinations, you have one giant model that covers all of the language combinations and you get rid of the pivot of English. It's kind of one of the little secrets that you, even if you go, let's say, German, Lithuanian, you still go via English. But apparently these models, they don't do that. I mean, you know, anybody interested in the details, go read that paper. But, you know, there for Facebook, one of the reasons, of course, is to reduce, to go with to try to figure this out on a kind of a very large model instead of having to have all these individual engines, is that it reduces the complexity of the MT per se, and that it's more efficient, and then it allows transfer learning. So, you know, the system learns for, let's say, Thai into Khmer, it can actually apply some of the lessons it learned from German into French for like very low resource languages where there's not a lot of data. I mean, how is the environment in Southeast Asia in terms of MT? Do people use it? Like maybe more also on a consumer side, do you see any of that being applied? Like when you travel to some of these, you know, countries that, well, again, it's not German, it's not France, it doesn't have a ton of data.
Well, before I talk about that, first I want to say congratulations to you and the editorial team and the research team, because Facebook calling us to have this sort of chat is to be honest, a wonderful recognition of, you know, us being a source of news and information in the marketplace. So well done there. I think that's worth a pat on the back if you can share that with the team. And then also on what you said about low rank language resources, it has been an issue on the B2B side here in Southeast Asia. So for me living in Thailand, I can use, you know, a phone app and get some basic translations on a very rudimentary level. And so those sort of apps are becoming more and more prevalent. However, you know, there is a genuine issue, and there has been for some time, in inter-Asian trade. So Japanese, Korean, and Chinese investing in Southeast Asia, and these inter-Asian language pairs, or even trade within Southeast Asia, you know, it's been very, very difficult. So this kind of development is in really big news if it really does bear that fruit. And if it can be then put into the commercial side, then you know, that will be, I think, really big news for business out here in Southeast Asia and other low resource language areas, like maybe India or maybe the Middle East.
Yeah, and I mean, Facebook's motivation is not B2B, but basically the progress they're making will eventually benefit B2B cases as well, business to business, right? I mean, their primary driver is having the having content on the platform machine translated into or monitor content that's being, you know, generated by users in all kinds of languages. But eventually, again, these models, I mean, many of them are open source, so that you can take them and apply them to a B2B context. Actually, Google, we noticed another paper that came out from Google just yesterday or the day before, and it was also about massive multilingual NMT. And basically, they concluded, let me quote this, "Finally, we stress tested that system at scale and demonstrate that we can train the model with up to 111 times 112 language pairs, which is 12,432 language pairs, and it provides competitive translation quality for all language pairs." So that's, I mean, you know, 100 times 100, obviously 10,000, right? So once you want to do direct, the language combination and the number of language combinations just escalates super quickly. So yeah, look, Facebook, by all means, get in touch whenever you have an announcement. Maybe you can get in touch half a day before you actually publish the post, and we'll keep it embargoed. So be our guest. Just as we transition over to Kim, the conversation with Kim, there was a piece of news around Zoom, which is very relevant to RSI, remote simultaneous interpreting. So Zoom announced this week that they are adding Zapps, like Zoom apps, or just other apps on their platform. You have like Asana for productivity, HubSpot for sales and marketing, or for transcription, I think they have rev.com. But there is no RSI option yet. And I'm going to be interested to learn from Kim, maybe how, you know, what's the plan if maybe Zoom is going to add, you know, what their process is, or maybe not. We probably can't talk about it. It's probably a confidential process at this point in time. But the interesting thing is that Zoom is adding additional additional apps there, and RSI is not filled yet. It definitely will be. There will be an RSI app at some point on Zoom, and probably on Microsoft. I think when we ran the story about Interprefy yesterday, we asked them about Zoom, and they said they're already interpreting via Zoom, so it works, but it's probably not yet it's not the default option yet. Their technology. So let's see how that turns out. Great. So, Andrew, you should join the pod again.
Well, thanks for having me, and thanks for the opportunity to talk a little bit about SlatorCon Remote. I mean, just as it relates to the stories that you said, everything that we talked about with Facebook makes it really very interesting to hear from someone like Constantine at Intento when he talks about the intent and use of machine translation in different business contexts. So I think it's going to be a very exciting event. So please join us on December 3rd if you're interested. And in the meantime, thanks, Florian, for having me, and I hope to join again soon.
Of course. Let's have maybe for Christmas or something, we have a special team pot.
Celebration with the team. That's a great idea.
There you go. Okay. Cool. Well, and so we're going to hop over to Kim in just 1 second.
Thanks, Florian.
And we're back. We're back here with Kim Ludvigsen, the founder and CEO for another 2 weeks of remote simultaneous interpreting provider Interprefy. Hi, Kim.
Hi, Florian.
I don't have to ask you where you are. Typically, I ask people in this podcast where they are. You're in Zurich. I'm in Zurich, but we're still doing this remote.
Yes, I thought we should have. I thought it would have been a good occasion to get together physically. It's always fun to meet you, and you're just around the corner, 100 meters from here. But obviously, you're so used to this way of producing your podcast, so it's fine. We can do it this way. But of course, I would have preferred to see you in person. But
We do meet occasionally on the street.
Yes.
And or actually now I moved my office. It's a little bit further up the hill. But anyway, You know, we're talking remote, so we're going to have to do this remote. We're talking remote simultaneous interpreting, so this needs to be remote.
Exactly. And we do more and more remote. We started the whole business idea behind Interprefy was to provide remote interpreters, not to have them in booths. It's expensive to bring in these booths, and sometimes you have to have flying interpreters. So we said, okay, the interpreters can be remote. And then we found out, okay, but also the guest speakers can be remote. A lot of participants don't want to fly in, or they miss the flight or whatever. So they can be remote. So more and more people are remote. And then after COVID, we suddenly, everybody, you know, all events disappeared from all conferences from almost one day to the other. No conferences, zero business at the end of February. And then our clients started calling us and they said, oh, you have remote interpreters and some guest speakers are remote. Can you have everybody remote? And then we said, yeah, of course. So now we run web conferencing. Our platform has become a web conferencing platform.
There you go. So this is second home for you. So we'll definitely get back to COVID. We'll get back to Interprefy as a company. So first of all, you know, congratulations. This is a big week for you. I mean, you're passing on the CEO baton to Annette Polaszewski-Plot. Congrats. So can you just maybe tell us a bit more about what happened this week? We know we published an article where you're handing over. You see you and Annette there. So just tell us a bit more what happened and what led to that decision as well.
Well, if I go back a step, I founded Interprefy 6 years ago, actually on Tuesday. It's exactly 6 years ago since I went to the Handelsregister, the company register of Zurich, and I incorporated Interprefy. You know, in the beginning, it was so tough and no salary and no nothing. And then I managed to convince some very, very talented people to join Interprefy. And then it went step by step. And this is now 6 years ago. And things are going phenomenally well now. We have one record month after the other. We are tripling revenues. We are hiring like crazy. Everybody works 200%. It's really crazy. So when things are going good, I think it's a good, we're riding on this COVID wave of success, and that's also a good moment to reinforce and also change the management. So Annette, she will bring a lot. She's very complementary to me. I will stay active for Interprefy and dedicate and focus more on business development, partnerships, and strategy and sort of long-term developments, whereas she will run the business operations. She will strengthen our structure and workflow, something which is not exactly my talent. I'm more the creative guy. So I think it is really a big gain that we managed to find Annette.
So she was with PayPal and Eventbrite before, right?
And exactly, yeah. And I hope very much, unfortunately, she couldn't be with us today because she's celebrating a big birthday. It's her birthday today.
Congrats, but, Annette.
Yeah. Congratulations, Annette. But you will probably make another podcast with her in the future when she's a bit better established and she can tell a bit more her first sort of impressions.
Yeah, I mean, you hand it over, but I think the technical handover is in a couple of weeks or something, right? You mentioned in two weeks.
Yeah, well, on Wednesday, I did the announcement, and she will, the 9th of November is her official beginning. So we made, since we don't have that many people here in Zurich, we were about a dozen people here in Zurich, and we have over 100 people spread over the globe, and they connected remotely on our platform. So it was like a remote town hall meeting. And then I explained a bit about the background, and I sort of build up the tension. And then Annette came in on the stage, and everybody applauded, and she presented herself, and I think it was very good. We had a long Q&A session, and you know, everybody are very happy. They think it's a good move. It will strengthen our management, but also there's continuity. I remain with Interprefy. I will focus on what I'm good at.
Hmm. So let's talk a bit about your background, right? I mean, you're not, originally from the language industry, right? I mean, tell us a bit more about your professional background, how you got to be in Switzerland, and what were your, what did you do before Interprefy?
Well, I am originally Danish, and I moved to Switzerland. Was actually with my parents. I stayed in Denmark in a boarding school. I finished high school. Then I came to Zurich. I went to the ETH. So I'm an engineer by training, and I went into consulting. I did an MBA at INSEAD in France. And then I came back, and I worked mainly in consulting, corporate finance, the startup scene. I have founded some other companies. And then this is, what was that? This is more than 10 years ago. It's incredible. Yeah, it's I worked for the Swiss Post. I did innovation and M&A for the Swiss Post. And I had to organize these conferences, and the Swiss Post has to be politically correct, with the French and Italian speaking Swiss. So they provided this equipment for simultaneous interpreting. And then I looked at this equipment. I said, what is this? It dates back to the 60s. It's really old fashioned technology. Why isn't there an app? Why do you need these funny, like these headphones and booth and all that stuff? The interpreters can be remote. And then I didn't really think of it, and I left the Swiss Post. And then suddenly one day, Peter Fry, a friend of, an old colleague, he called me. And I usually, I said, how shall I go to Aarau, and meet him there? But then I said, usually when he suggests to meet, there's something behind. And then he said, well, this thing you were talking about back in at the Swiss Post with the having the interpreters remote, why don't we take that up again? And I said, oh, that's a great idea. And you know what's really funny? I pulled out this first sketch we had. Okay, so
show us.
And this is true. This is not a joke. So this, unfortunately, I need to go in here. Okay, so here, unfortunately, okay, this is the really the very first sketch we did together, and I kept that because I knew one day this would become a huge success. So I know this sheet I should keep.
For yeah. all those who are listening to this now, now is really the time to go to YouTube and hit the subscribe button and you know, make sure you see that.
I think so. I think really people should and all the yes. And yes, so that was how the same thing how this Interprefy started, and then in the beginning it was very tough. And you know, most startups, they, you know, let's face it, 90% fail. But I said to myself, I had this vision, you know, I had this dream or vision, where I said to myself, if I manage to create a profitable company and hand it over to like a real professional, because I'm an entrepreneur, I like startup things, and you know, this is very good in the beginning, but if I can hand it over to somebody better suited for the next, for the industrial phase, that being able to do so and pay that person, that would be a success. And that would be, if I get that far, I could be proud. So the last couple of months, we have had a tremendous development, and it's better to change when things go up than when things go down. So I went to the board and I said, look, I think now, and I also have a certain age, you don't believe it, but I'm a bit older, definitely much older than you, Florian.
Really, Kim?
Yes. And I said, yeah, I think it's good to change now. And they said, okay. But it's on two conditions. It's two conditions. First of all, Kim, you need to remain connected. You are the sort of Aushängeschild or the face of Interprefy. And Ottman, who you know, he says, Kim, the CEO, it's a chief evangelist officer. So I'm the evangelist. I spread the gospel. So they said, oh, you have to stay and remain, and you have to focus on what you're good at, you know, business development ideas, but we have to find somebody who complement you, and we have to find really a good new successor. So we started a search process, and we were very, very fortunate at a very early stage, and it was a bit great luck because Annette, she's from Berlin and her network is there, and she wanted to work there, and then her husband got a job in Zurich and they have a small daughter, so she said, okay, if I can find somebody in Zurich. But she really liked what we do, and we have this momentum, and she's very committed and very eager to get up and running. She's very good at in sales. She had led and managed huge sales teams, and she will bring in strength in the sales, the structure, improve our workflows, and of course also with me develop the strategy. So we are very fortunate to find her, and then we made the announcement on Wednesday, and I think it was very good, and everybody were very happy, and she starts on November 9th.
Excellent. So, I mean, yeah, you did achieve that milestone you set yourself, right? Let's go back to the early days and maybe go through some of that in terms of the financing, right? So you start this company, you maybe bootstrap a little bit originally, but I mean, we've covered a number of financing rounds for Interprefy. So just tell us a little bit more about how this whole thing was financed up to date and, like, you know, what are you planning going forward? Because, yeah, it was kind of a startup in the sense that there was an initial investment, some bootstrapping also, but then, you know, how did you get it to that point in terms of finance?
Okay, that we got that far, which we are today, is not me. It's the people. It's a very, very talented people I found. I think this is my modest contribution to this success, is the capability of finding and convincing people. In the beginning, you know, they said, well, what salary can we get? And I said, sorry, I can't give you a salary, but you have to pay me. You have to give Interprefy money and invest. And people did that, and it's the best investments I've ever done, though the management which invested early. And I think also sort of a quality I have is to go out to investors, and I went out early, and Zurich is a good place, and I come from the corporate finance world industry. I know a lot of VC companies and also private business angels. I have a big network. So I managed very early to convince investors to finance us. So we got a lot of money at a very early stage. And this is why we have had this great success. If you compare to other RSI platforms, which started at the same time with us, they I think were good people also and good ideas and good prototypes. We just got a lot of money and that has helped us. And we closed this financing round, which sort of we agreed upon. That was in beginning of the year, and then it was closed in the summer. And then also Technology Fund, which you know, this Swiss government fund, which supports environmental, which improves environment, companies.
Sustainable business.
Maybe, sustainability is the key word, yes. Yeah. Exactly. So we got money from them, and we're also profitable. So we generate cash. So we will invest. We will step up our investments and in development, and perhaps also acquisition. So we are in a very comfortable position.
Interesting. So let's move to like the capabilities, the offering, and some of the challenges in RSI. Right. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that has to get. That has to be right for an RSI platform to work. So, you know, just tell us a bit more about, again, the offering, the capabilities, but also the key challenges in doing remote simultaneous interpreting, because it's not easy for.
Yeah, I think a great advantage and also what helped us to attract investors, it's very, very easy to explain the business model. You have a conference, you have simultaneous interpreting, you get rid of the booth, interpreters don't have to travel, and you can just use standard devices. So it's very easy to understand. But of course, we also have to build the platform. So I would say the core of Interprefy is this RSI platform. And then we also offer interpreters. They are not employed by us. They're freelancers. But of course, most clients also want interpreters. And we can search the best suited interpreters for that particular event with that terminology. We can find them and get them and hire them wherever they live in the world. And this is a great advantage. Most clients want us to provide the interpreters. Then we have the professional services, which is project management and support. This is very important for bigger projects to provide a good support to the point of hand-holding, where we really set up everything and guide the delegates. And of course, we take well care of the interpreters. So we have a lot of remote support. And also media library, transcripts, and so on are new services we are offering. And you ask, what are the key challenges?
Well, technical challenges maybe as well, right? I mean, interpreting, you know, you got the visual cues, you got material that the client provides when you're in a booth. I mean, you know, I remember from like some of our talks years ago that this was a challenge also from the onboarding of interpreters, that, you know, just the interaction for also from a linguistic point of view. What are some of the linguistic challenges? What are some of the technical challenges to make this work?
Well, I mean, the technical challenges, I must say, it's not that difficult. It is not rocket science, okay? But many, you know, you can say any e-commerce platform, that's not, Uber is not rocket science, Airbnb is not rocket science. It's very simple business ideas and simple platforms. Nevertheless, these companies are extremely successful. And in the case of us, well, it was mainly what was very important. We was listening to the clients. I think that our success at the very beginning, we went out to clients without even having a product. And then they were interested. Then I found Andre, our CTO, and he was very, and I tried with several people before and didn't work. And then he was very fast. So the technology we developed very quickly, I would say the main challenges were more the general inertia, in the market, you know, people say, well, yeah, it sounds interesting. And then they still did it the old way because that was they were used to. And that has, of course, been dramatically changed with COVID, because now they had to change. The only way they could get the event up and running was with RSI.
So let's talk about that. COVID, obviously, game changer of, you know, epic proportion for so many businesses. And, you know, anything that's, well, yeah, that's cloud-based, that's remote, benefited tremendously. So, you know, give us some anecdotes. What happened? So it's February. It slowly starts building up. Then, you know, where the lockdown was like in late March. What happened?
Yeah, well, already in February, we just saw, you say, oh, the events are canceled, no business. And we finished Q1 a third of the budget. And we really had to downgrade the forecast for the year. And of course, we are not very nervous. But then we had clients coming back to us and say, can you do everything remote? And I said, yeah, of course we can do that. And like the UN, I've been courting the UN organizations for 4 years. And the procurement process is 3 to 9 months. It's very complicated. And I remember in the beginning, you know, we discussed it, and Otman and I, we sat Friday evening until midnight, and then we submitted that's still afternoon in America. And Sunday morning, we had the confirmation. And it had to go straight up to the director general. He had to bypass all the processes. So they were very happy that they could still these very important events for, you can say, for the world. You know, a lot of them was about the pandemic, and these conferences had to take place at any cost. And we did that, and we did that successfully, and they're very happy.
So let's talk about this example, or maybe general as well. Like, they run this on any, they would run this on Zoom, on Teams, or what have you, and then you guys would be the layer on top of this, or how does it work?
Yeah. Typically, well, right? Yes. In the beginning, of course, it was running on our platform, and then not only the UN, but most clients. And then people started using Zoom. I mean, Zoom really had the breakthrough. They went for, I don't know, a couple of million to 100 million users within a few weeks. So Zoom, you know, a lot of the online meetings take place on Zoom, but there are also a lot of other platforms. The client came to us and they say, well, yeah, it's fine, but then another. Yeah, having another platform, and we need to, you know, explain people, and then we, as you correctly said, then we develop like a plugin where the user actually he's in his Zoom meeting, and those who want who need interpreting, they have to select. They have to select a language, and then we provide the interpreting. So the event runs on both platforms, and the interpreters work on our platform because we have, a specially designed interpreter interface for the interpreters, and they prefer to use that one.
Let's talk about the interpreters. I do remember we had some initial discussion. We had discussions like 3-4 years ago where you told me there was some kind of skepticism towards RSI, and you actually went out and spoke to a lot of people at these events and to the interpreters directly. Can you just tell us a bit more about like the objections from interpreters, but both pre-COVID and now? Like, how has it changed? Has it changed? And
Yeah, it's very difficult for interpreters now to have bring up arguments against RSI. And actually, we have so many interpreters coming us. They're desperate. And I understand. I mean, it's tragic. They lost all their business, the conference interpreters, from one day to the other. And, you know, I don't know, you are sort of independent consultant. You live from the the work you can generate, and it went down to zero. Now it's up to 30, 40, 50% now, and it's recovering. So that has changed. But before, of course, they had all kind of excuses. Why RSI was bad, and it was like someone, and they had to answer this. Oh, this is the work of the devil. It is dangerous. And one interpreter, he said, and it was a half a joke and half true. He says, I don't know it, so it must be bad. You know,
that's probably tongue in cheek. But like, did you see any difference between different, I don't know, countries, regions, age groups?
Yeah, of course, there's especially the older interpreters are not so afraid of technology. And from the beginning, young interpreters embraced RSI. And I understand they were a bit reluctant in the beginning. That's natural. And now they try it out and then they work with it. And there's something I've always emphasized from the very beginning. You know, I really don't understand why interpreters are sort of reluctant or critical about RSI, because it brings more business, it brings more work for the interpreters, because we see a lot of avoiding this equipment and traveling. Of course, the interpreters are, it's real interpreters, they are there, they have to be paid, that doesn't change. But the overall cost of providing the service goes down. And you know, from microeconomics, where the cost of a product goes down, demand goes up. And we see that one to one. We see a lot of smaller organizations which previously they said, no, we cannot afford it, it's too expensive. Simultaneous interpreting is something for the, you know, rich organizations, big organizations, and now everybody can afford it. So we democratize and simultaneous interpreting. We enable everybody to use simultaneous interpreting, and we, you know, across, we break down walls, we provide, enable communication across the language barriers and borders. And this is our mission. And I think it's an important mission and it's a good mission. And we want to do this with the interpreters, and it brings them more business.
You mentioned that you're seeing smaller firms that probably wouldn't have looked at simultaneous interpreting in the past now taking it up. Like, currently, what are some of the heaviest users of RSI? And do you think that's going to change in the future, or has COVID basically kind of accelerated the future, and the future is here already, so there's not going to be a major change?
COVID has definitely accelerated. I don't think the booths are coming back. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, to some extent, but not the before we had to sort of convince the interpreters and the clients to say, no, booths are not necessary. And now they're gone. They're just gone. COVID did that. This change has already taken place.
But is it like international organizations that's by far one? Or do you have like big corporates, I don't know, like big global companies that have like international management meetings, or like what are some of the key client segments you're servicing?
Well, we have a lot of NGOs. Basically, you can say any organization which have people speaking in different languages, wanting to communicate orally in different languages, they need simultaneous interpreting. They need RSI. We have a lot of sports organization, international sports, any kind of international, whatever, associations. Big multinational corporations in the pharma industry. We are very big. Fintech, manufacturing, you name it. Multi-level marketing, MLM, is using it a lot. And of course, also still conferences, any kind of international conferences. So it's very mixed. But as I said, also small organization, you know, I don't know, the Auditor Association of Belgium, whatever, you know, they live from membership fees, and usually they could not afford simultaneous interpreting, and now they can.
Hmm. We briefly spoke about some of the bigger video conferencing platforms. So you said you have a plugin there or something, but generally, how does it work? How do you work with those big, the Zooms, the Teams, the, I don't know, Google Meet, or how does the collaboration there work? Is there like, are these official integrations? Is it kind of you're building something that they don't even know about at this point? And yeah, how does that work?
Okay, sometimes it's something we can do that independently of the platform, because we can just take the feed, the sound and the video from the platform, we put it into our platform, so now it's on our platform, that's what the interpreters see, and they give the audio back in various languages, and then of course the client can either have an app, so they select, and with our app, they select the language, and those who need interpreting, they put on a headset, so they have both the Zoom meeting or whatever on the screen, and our app on the smart device. And now we are launching a little widget on the laptop, which actually just have to select the language, and then it can even sort of feed it back into the meeting. And we have also, we are on the MS Teams, we are also there getting integrated on their platform.
Did you see that announcement around Zoom Zapps, which were actually, by the time this goes public, this podcast is out, we're recording a day before, we're going to be running a short story on that, because Zoom's adding like different apps that they, like preferred apps. Like, do you think that's the way to go, that some of these big platforms will like select individual RSI solutions as kind of their official partners, and that's one way to get business? Or
yes, it's actually, well, that's what's happening. And I think first of all, I think these platforms, none of them want to go become an LSP. None of them wants to provide interpreting, but what they want to provide is a link or a connection where the information of the event they have created is led into the, there will be multiple, I think most of them will probably use, not have one RSI provider, but have multiple, so the client can choose and perhaps compare. And you can actually look at a bit like when you order an airplane ticket, you're asked, do you want a rental car? And then it already knows the date and everything, and then it makes suggestions, and then you have to pick one of them. It will be a bit same thing. You have an event, and they say, do you need simultaneous interpreting? And then there might be different providers offering in parallel. I could imagine a similar development.
But you probably want to, I mean, I'm sure you are, and probably can't talk about it, but I'm sure you're talking to a lot of these bigger platforms, and you want to be kind of highlighted, showcased, being
option, right? Yes, we are working with all of them. We are in discussion with all of the big platforms, and we have actually an integration with several. We have us designed, we have signed a distribution agreement with SpotMe, On24, BlueJeans. They are integrating our platform.
Good for you. Yes. So you guys kind of disrupted, or the RSI space disrupted the SI space, the in-person, and then COVID disrupted everything. But like, what are your thoughts about the next steps of disruption? We're on Slator, we're covering a lot of technology, and what we've seen over the past 18 months, major push into speech-to-speech, MT. So yeah, what are your thoughts around that? How far is it? Is it already being used? Are people talking to you about this as being an option, etc.?
Well, I mean, it is coming, but it's so funny, and you know, I have to be a bit careful what I say. But I attend or get invited to a lot of language conferences, and it's a bit like, I feel that this topic of machine interpreting, or what do you want to call it, speech to text. Speech-to-speech translation, which is actually is a very correct term. I mean, that is coming, that is sneaking in, but it's funny. It's almost like an elephant in the room, a pink elephant in the room. Everybody knows it, and nobody really wants to talk about it, but it's coming.
Hmm. But you don't see this as a major immediate threat. I mean, you know, we've been this podcast, we're talking to a lot of like LSP founder that on in the text space. So there it's quite far advanced with post editing, etc. You don't see it. I mean, I don't think if there's a way to post edit speech to speech, right? So it's either a human does it or there is a machine doing it, but you don't see this happening in the next 2 to 5 years. I mean, I don't know, to give a timeline on it.
First of all, it's amazing. I've seen that there are people who sit and correct live. I mean, they do this within 1-2 seconds delay. There are technologies to do that, to edit so before it's the speech generation, it's edited, and they do that. And I mean, it's amazing. There are also videos, I think, on YouTube where you can see that. I think we can, and this is also what I go out and I talk to people and I talk to my colleagues and I talk in the LSP industry. I think there are many parallels from the translation industry, what happened, how technology transformed the translation industry, there are parallels, and we can learn from that. We can learn from that development. But of course, there's one huge difference, and that is translation is you deliver that later, whereas that is also getting into like real-time translation, or you know, the delay is being really shortened. But of course, simultaneous interpreting is always real-time. So you know, there's not much time, if any, to do correction, and this is a huge difference. But it's coming, and I think when you look at there are these models of how computer AI takes over more and more, and I think it's a question about time. When will and I think we can have the like you know the Turing test.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So there will be an whatever we were calling it, we could call it the Slator test. That would be a good Slator test. The Slator test. Sorry?
Let's brand it that way. That's
an idea. We have to do that together, okay? So the Slator test is when a machine interprets, you hear the interpreter, and you cannot tell whether it's a human being or an interpreter, okay? This is a well-defined moment. It's a very easy test. You see, can you hear any difference or not? And your question is, okay, when will that be? When will that be?
Tough.
There's so many.
Depends on the setting, right? I mean, if it's like a call with a supplier, and it's a very basic conversation, but you know, if it's a lively conference discussion, that's a challenge of a different magnitude, I guess.
Exactly. Of course, there are things like humor, irony is extremely difficult, particularly when you have a conversation which changes the whole time. There, the machines often break down, and they will for a long time. But if you have like a manuscript, even if it's a very complicated matter, you know, a science conference, the machine in the beginning, you know, they can you can feed them, you can teach the machine, you know, the difficult words, you have a glossary which you can put in. So I think there will be uses where machines will do simultaneous interpreting before we know it. We are of course also working on this technology, but I think what we can also learn is in translation industry, you know, then the first CAT tools came, and everybody, oh, it was like it will kill the profession. No, the translators have more work than ever, but it's different. It's different. It's, as you said, it's post-editing. So the machines will do all the easy stuff and the sort of intellectually challenging the translators will do, and that will be something different, something similar for the interpreters. We will still need interpreters in the future, but they will not sit and interpret live in a booth. I think that will be phased out.
Mm-hmm. Now, you're trilingual. Have you ever tried to interpret yourself, maybe run a quick test on the platform?
Well, I have a lot of respect for those who have done simultaneous interpreting. It is very strenuous and it's a hard training. It's highly qualified people. I have a lot of respect. So I would never dare to sort of try it live. I will never do that. But of course, I've done it when we do demos. I've done it. And
I mean, yeah, that's why I'm asking, because I was also, I'm a translator by training, and then we could have, you know, added 2 years of interpreting studies, and we did do a few trials, and I just lose my train of thought in like 5 to 10 seconds. So I really admire interpreters that can actually, you know, do this for 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 1 hour. I think they probably shouldn't go much longer.
Some of them are amazing. I mean, you really need to split your brain in two, and as I said, I have a lot of respect, and this is also why they're always working in pairs, because it's so strenuous. You know, after 10 minutes, you're done, and then your body interpreter takes over. You know, good interpreters, there will be for a long time a need for them. And as you correctly said, there are simple stuff where it doesn't really matter. And there are already apps. I mean, there are apps, in simple apps in the market. You can just, you know, download an app. But I remember there was one guy, he tried out this app and he said, yeah, it's fine, but, you know, I would never negotiate $100 million deal with that app. And it's like, when you need to be very, very precise, you know, legal negotiation or something, or, you know, medical something, you don't use a wrong term. Okay.
Yeah. Great. Well, that was super interesting, Kim. Thanks so much for taking the time to come on SlatorPod. And again, congratulations on the transition. I'm sure you're going to be super busy going forward as well. And, you know, I really, I'm wishing Annette the great start and hope to get her on the pod and, you know, when she's well settled in.
Great. And if I just may add, you know, we're scaling up very fast, and we have this wave of orders coming, we can hardly handle it. So, you know, I'm saying we need to automize self-provisioning. You know, we cannot for everything offer this, the very thorough, you know, the professional services. So we are launching very soon, and I think this is a topic for another podcast, this self-provisioning platforms for LSPs, where they can actually use our platform as a SaaS platform. They just go in and say what they want, when, you know, the time and languages and so on and so on, and then they get back everything, tokens and everything is automated, and it's going to be called Plexer, and it will be launched very soon.
Plexer?
It's PLXR. .com.
Plexer. Okay, get it.
Yeah. I'll send you some information or a press release. And of course, we will, Slator will be the first to announce it.
First to know. Awesome.
First to know, yes.
Great. Well, congratulations on that as well. And, you know, I guess I'll see you on the street sometime when I venture down. Although now, you know, with the new restrictions, let's see how far I get.
Yeah, it's amazing. We are both global companies. I mean, you have an office in Singapore, and you're really, Slator is global, and so are we. We have 90% of our people are outside Switzerland, 80% of our business is outside Switzerland, and then we happen to be around the corner, so we can either meet up here at the Monocle Cafe, or you're, of course, also welcome here anytime, Florian.
Yeah, but it was great doing this over video, or again, remote, right? We had to do that. Cool. All right, Kim, thanks so much.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Okay, cheers.
Bye.
Bye.